been asked to rearrange slightly the order, so and also to step in to chair this keynote plus panel. So very quick introduction, because we want to get to people that we actually want to hear, not me. It is said that no one knows the future with certainty. That is not true. The next four speakers actually do know the future with certainty, and they will be telling you precisely what's about to occur. So that's a great opportunity. Very quickly, in terms of who will be speaking, first we'll have the third keynote speaker, John Coffey, who really is one of the top legal scholars in the country. If he were in our country, in the U.S., my country, if he were a rock star or a professional athlete, he would be called by a single name like Madonna or Pele. I won't go on. And then we also have, in the order here, Dr. Ariel Flavian. I hope I did justice to the pronunciation, who is an expert in apparently real estate law and class actions. I think those are two expertises, but I'm not certain. And obviously a gracious and generous host. And thank you so much. We also have David Isaac, who is a co-chair of JNDLegal Administration, and I think does a fair amount of handling of class action settlements. And also has a gift for brevity, he promises me. So he's gonna help us catch up somewhat on time. He also needs to get to Jerusalem for Shabbat. So depending on how things go, if he gets up and leaves in the middle, it is not necessarily because of anything anyone said.
Maybe.
But it could be that too, right? Coincidences do happen. And then finally, Professor Stefaan, who's already been introduced. I'll just add that you could tell by his comments he's an opera buff, and I found out he's a wonderful meal companion as well, so that's a pleasure. So we'll start then with Professor Coffey giving the third keynote address.
Thank you. Let me begin by telling you, this is sort of a cautionary note, that there are several well-known metrics for evaluating and ranking complex phenomena. For example, in the world of earthquakes, we have the Richter scale, 1 Richter, 2 Richter, up to 8 Richter, whatever, well-known. In the United States, when you evaluate keynote speakers, we have something called the Miller scale. And the perfect performance is called a 1 Arthur performance. Last night you saw the 1 Arthur. I usually come in at about 0.1, 0.2, somewhere around it, maybe as high as 0.25. What I'm telling you is lower your expectations. You're not going to get a 1 Arthur performance. Okay. Now, my aim is to be a little bit provocative. But you know, the line between being provocative and being obnoxious is a little hazy, and sometimes I cross it. So if David over here gets up and leaves, I'd probably cross the line, okay? But I want to start with this phrase that may put your teeth on edge. I think to some degree, with the notable exception of Arthur a few minutes ago, we've been a little too rule-obsessed, and we're saying, here are the rules, and you have to change this rule. U.S. is filled with legal realists. We don't look at what the rule says. We look at what happens in court. What are the outcomes? Count the outcomes, not what the rule says, because rules, Japan is a country that has wonderful rules, none of which affect how litigation actually works. Okay? For that reason, I think that we need to move a little bit away from just talking about whether you have an opt-out or an opt-in class action. And this is where my talk really begins. We have something in the U.S. that I would call an entrepreneurial culture. Arthur was just telling you that, stealing, as usual, off everything I was about to say. But entrepreneurial litigation can be defined as litigation in which the plaintiff's attorney acts as a risk-taking entrepreneur. That will shock the English, but he acts as a risk-taking entrepreneur, both financing and managing the litigation for numerous clients who necessarily have correspondingly smaller stakes in litigation. No one has a bigger stake in a class action than class counsel. Everyone else has got those little negative value claims. In the U.S., the domain of entrepreneurial litigation includes class actions, but also derivative actions, which much preceded class actions by decades, qui-tam actions, and consolidated mass tort actions, which are getting larger and larger and larger as a percentage of all litigation. Entrepreneurial litigation has generally been unknown outside the United States, with partial exceptions for Australia, Canada, and Israel. And what links those three countries, you can speculate, I don't purport to know. In large part, this is because entrepreneurial litigation develops best in an environment with three critical elements. I'm glad this is up in writing so you don't think I'm just copying what Arthur just said, but I'm going to give you basically the elements he mentioned also. I'll call the first one broad claim aggregation. This is achieved in the U.S. through the opt-out class action and through consolidation of mass torts. And the person in the mass tort case has no right to opt out, and maybe even more under the control of the lead counsel than the person in the class action. Okay, next, the second element of entrepreneurial litigation is the contingent fee, which offers both high incentives, sufficient to overcome high risk, and also allows small claimants with negative value claims to effectively find a way to compensate their attorneys. Otherwise, no one would take their cases because they can't afford the fee for an individual attorney. All right. Third, immunity from loser pays fee shifting. This is the American rule that each side bears its own expenses generally. There can be special cases where sanctions are imposed, but they're very special cases. Now, those are the three elements. There are other elements. In the U.S., we have civil juries. That scares defendants. It adds some unpredictability, and it gives you somewhat greater ability to negotiate settlements because no one knows the mind of a jury. We also have punitive damages, a lesser factor, but it adds somewhat to the total risk and assists the world of entrepreneurial litigation. Now, historically, Europe has had none of these elements. To the extent the class action is recognized in Europe, and that's a recent phenomenon, it is still usually an opt-in class action with a few exceptions. And when there's an opt-out class action, it's basically for special causes of action. For example, Britain will allow it now for antitrust actions, but not for other kinds of class actions. Okay. Then there are also special rules in much of Europe. It may be that the class has to have a public body as the lead representative. Not a bad idea necessarily, but it means a very different world than one in which the private entrepreneur could put all these elements together, because there's got to be this public body leading class action. Outside the U.S. and in Canada, the contingent fee is generally forbidden to attorneys, or at least it's strongly discouraged. We don't see much reliance upon it outside of Canada, the United States, and actually there are contingent fees in China too. But this pattern is changing, as others on this panel will tell you. As some countries, including Japan, Korea, and in 2015, the UK for antitrust class actions, have either authorized some form of an opt-out class or have authorized some alternative arrangements, including some tolerance, I won't say encouragement, but some tolerance for the contingent fee. However, this is going to be most of my talk, more important than these legal changes, we're finding that the restrictions that exist in Europe and elsewhere can be outflanked by innovative legal engineering conducted by basically entrepreneurial lawyers. And we'll see how they are doing it. And it means that the formal restraints may not be enough to keep the world of entrepreneurial litigation from coming. I'm going to suggest that it's coming over the transom, under the door, through cracks in the window, but it is coming, and we'll see. I don't predict the full outcome. Now, in making this prediction, I want to underline, though, the European attitude has been one still of conservative resistance. Although desiring some mechanism for collective redress, Europe has feared the American disease. They use that term regularly in their literature, and they've adamantly resisted most of the elements of the U.S. entrepreneurial litigation model. This could change, we'll hear about that, but right now I would focus on the, in 2013, the European Commission adopted recommendations on common principles for injunctive and compensatory collective redress mechanisms that are non-binding, but they go out of their way to reject most of the key elements of the U.S. model. Specifically, the recommendation insists on an opt-in principle requiring the express consent of all claimants to be represented in the class, and that opt-in means you can't have by one stroke an opt-out class action covering everyone. Maybe the opt-in can work, but it's much more costly, much more difficult. There is still a prohibition on contingent fees in this recommendation. Again, it's not mandatory law, but it reflected the consensus of the participating states to put this out. They want to continue a loser pay rule under which the winning party is paid its legal costs by the losing party. But the reality of this is the costs of plaintiffs and defendants are the cost of a rabbit versus a horse. And that kind of trade very much chills the willingness of a plaintiff to sue if all those large corporate legal fees can be shifted to them in the event there's an outcome unfavorable. Even if you have a 75% chance of winning, the fact that there are dozens of millions of dollars of fees that defendants are racking up means you face a very big risk. Discount those 100 million in fees by 25%. That's still a big number to take a risk on if you're seeking only to get your $25 toaster repaired. Okay. Close regulation of litigation funding by third parties. I think that is desirable, but they've already in 2013, 4 years ago, were focused on third-party funding, and they wanted closer regulation of disclosure at the outset, and they continue to want the broad use of nonprofit entities to lead the class action in order to minimize the danger of lawyer-controlled classes. The U.S. was also concerned about that, and that's why we have the lead plaintiff rule in securities litigation, under which the largest institutional investor with the greatest losses will lead the class action. So I'm just suggesting there are some strong forces for inertia and resistance still there in Europe. Nonetheless, and this is the matrix I want you to focus on, entrepreneurial litigation may be developing at a rapid pace anyway. To the surprise of many, innovative attorneys, mainly from the United States, are finding ways to outflank the foregoing barriers by using alternatives to the class action. And this is the world in which there can be functional alternatives, substitutes for the traditional class action rules. So I said the first element of entrepreneurial litigation is some kind of claim aggregation, broad claim aggregation. You can get that. Our opt-out class action does it very quickly, very cheaply, but at more expense, you can do it in other ways. You can have consolidation through active solicitation by claim aggregators, and we're seeing that across the face of Europe now. I'll talk more about that. And you can have uses of special devices, such as the Dutch stichting. Stichting means foundation, translated literally, but it's a mechanism by which the shares of securities holders can be placed in a stichting. Ownership still is with the individual, but control over them is in the stichting, which can sue and can settle and doesn't have to go back and poll its members to get consent. That is being used in a number of cases now in the Netherlands, and it's basically being used for these huge settlement classes that are unique to the Netherlands but cover people all across the world. Okay. Next, financing. The U.S. has the contingent fee. It is cheap for one reason, because the attorney can evaluate the riskiness of the action much better than can a third-party litigation funder. But there is alternatives. Third-party funding based on a percentage of the recovery is possible, and we've seen it grow out of Australia and move broadly across much of Europe. The U.S. has it, but not in the context of class actions, because the court has to approve the attorney's fee, the amount that's going to be taken from the class, and that's a post-decision, that is a post-settlement or post-judgment decision, and the financing party, the third-party funder, wants an early decision that gives it a fixed amount of recovery. And those two are inconsistent. Okay. Finally, protection from fee shifting. The American rule does that, but the alternative, and it's a costly alternative, but it is an alternative, is liability insurance. And we have seen such insurance used. There are countries like Japan and South Korea which have actually passed legislation authorizing insurance to cover fee shifting. There are countries, Hong Kong, that has prohibited insurance from covering this because they very much like the old British rule. Okay, so we have, and how do you pay for this insurance? It's paid for by the third party funder. So when you negotiate with a third party funder, the largest element of cost, beyond even the cost of discovery, is the cost of D&O insurance to cover that fee shifting burden. Okay, now let's look more closely at some of these elements. Claim aggregation. Obviously, the opt-out class does this automatically, subject to a right to opt out, which is not much exercised outside of the world of securities litigation. Now, in Europe, the alternative, first alternative for claim aggregation would be if someone will take on the specialized and costly task of actively soliciting potential claimants to join together in asserting their claims and secure funding. But not only to secure funding, but to secure insurance and local counsel. Okay, how can this be done? Well, there are already specialists in this business of aggregating claims. In Brussels, for example, there is Demonor, a Brussels-based firm specializing in what it says is minority shareholder protection. But it's not a law firm, and it's not doing anything. It amounts to practicing law. It is rather getting people to give it the claim and to put it together through the device of a shtick team. In the U.S., we have a firm in Miami called DRRT, which, while it's a law firm, it isn't really practicing law. It's specializing in global representation, and it's got a website where it'll tell you that it can find you counsel to assert your claims all around the world. If you want to sue in Japan, Korea, Taiwan, it can find you counsel, and there are class mechanisms that can be used. Okay, so these are claim aggregators. Basically, they function as means by which we can get the small claimant that is automatically put in the class by the opt-out mechanism also into a form of legal representation by a counsel that will never meet them but will be introduced to them by the intermediary of the claims aggregator. Now, I mentioned earlier the shtick team, which is a novel-sounding word, but it's a Dutch legal entity, long established, with limited liability. It doesn't have shareholders or members. It's got a board of directors that's created by the instrument that creates it, which is typically a deed. And that deed creates the Stichting with a board of directors. Shares are transferred to the Stichting for purposes of litigation, although the proceeds will go back to the individual owners, the class, the people who are like class owners, like class members, but they are simply people who have transferred to the Stichting. And that means you can get a sizable mechanism, a sizable class together, but it is essentially an opt-in mechanism, more costly, imperfect, but it is working to some degree. Now, it still takes an entrepreneur to act as the catalyst and to assemble the necessary parties. And the parties here are our aggrieved investors, our claimants, our third-party funders, our insurance companies to protect against fee shifting, and the various soliciting agents that get together all of these members, and they all have to be paid. And the entrepreneur is the capitalist behind this, who's advancing the capital and taking some contingent risk. Who's been doing this so far? It's basically been played by the role of American law firms who had previously been handling these cases before the Morrison decision. Morrison versus National Australia Bank meant that the U.S. could no longer deal with litigation where the securities had traded offshore. Prior to that decision, if there was any conduct in the U.S., there could be a class certified. Sometimes it wouldn't be certified, sometimes it would, but if there was any significant context, this could be brought into the U.S. And institutional investors from around the globe had gotten used to getting some payment out of the U.S. when they invested in a company that went belly up and there were underwriters or someone else who could be held liable. Okay, and loser pays. Well, outside the U.S., this rule is standard, but it is applied differently between different jurisdictions. In the Netherlands, you shift a court-approved fee, which is probably only a small portion of the total fees incurred in the litigation. In the U.K., you shift everything, and the U.K. rule can be quite brutal and quite punitive. Okay, now let's look at the special position of a critical country, the Netherlands. With the U.S. Supreme Court's decision in Morrison in 2010, the ability of U.S. courts to effect a global resolution of multinational securities litigation was greatly curbed, but there were people who still wanted to get the benefits of that kind of global resolution. After Morrison, only securities trading in the U.S. can be litigated in the U.S. Okay, previously, we only had to have some substantial conduct. This has led to a search by plaintiff law firms and consultants, and even in some cases defendants, for an alternative form that can affect a global resolution of a dispute that sprawls across multiple national boundaries. So far, there's only one visible candidate, only one viable candidate for this role, the Netherlands. In 2005, the Netherlands enacted its Act on Collective Settlement of Mass Claims, which is called WICAM for short in Dutch. Okay, basically, had nothing to do with class actions. It was really an attempt to deal with mass torts that had produced significant birth defects, and they had to find, as a political matter, some way to get a resolution of these cases involving drugs that had caused massive birth defects. They adopted the Wickham statute because they talked to U.S. experts who told them that in mass tort cases, there was never a trial in the U.S., the thing's just settled. So they thought, I think imprecisely, that therefore you didn't need to have an authorization for a trial or litigation, just had to have authorization for a settlement. It is, however, beginning to work. Now, in 2005, this was enacted, which applies only to settlement classes. You can't sue under the statute, but you can settle. Why defendants settle if no one can sue them? I'm going to come to that, but it's not as simple as you might think. Now, under the Wickham statute, Netherlands is also attractive because of special Netherlands law. In the World Online decision, the Netherlands Supreme Court essentially adopted a near equivalent to the fraud on the market doctrine, which underlies almost all U.S. securities litigation, and eliminates the need to show reliance. Which means if you don't have to show reliance, you've got common issues of law of fact and no individual issue, and so you can certify things. Well, the World Online decision meant that securities litigation was going to be viable on an individual or on a shtick team basis in the Netherlands. In 2009, the Wickham statute was first used in a securities case. This was a case involving the Royal Dutch Shell Company. It was being sued in the U.S. And elsewhere. But the U.S. case was dismissed because there was insufficient conduct in the United States. At that point, the U.S. plaintiffs decide that they are going to settle on a weak basis, to be sure, the U.S. litigation, and they're going to then take everyone else to the Netherlands and do a Wickham settlement. The settlement was for a substantial number, $381 million. This is back in 2009, and $381 million was off the charts for Europe for a securities case. But it was the Royal Dutch Shell Company, the largest company in the Netherlands, and it wanted to settle. It wanted to get this resolved because the institutional investors were very unhappy, and it found this to be an attractive settlement number. It might have had to settle for $1 billion or more in the U.S. if all those people could have been in the United States, but this was attractive. Okay. The law firm that did this was a well-known plaintiff's law firm in the United States, Grant and Eisenhofer, which specializes in securities and corporate cases in Delaware and New York, basically. Okay. Now, the next step was the Converium decision in 2011. This case didn't involve really any significant person in the Netherlands. This was a case brought against major Swiss insurance companies, and it was brought by a worldwide consortium of investors suing Converium. There was only one citizen of the Netherlands involved in the whole case, but the Netherlands court said, yeah, the Wickham statute can apply even if there's only a peripheral presence in the Netherlands, just one nominal person, and you can go forward. Well, that opened the door to the ability to transport settlements to the Netherlands. So far, there have been 9 of these settlements, and the Netherlands Court of Appeals has approved 8 of them. That's a good ratio. I don't know what happened in that 9th case. Now let's get up to the Fortis case, because this is the case that has revolutionized things. Fortis was basically the largest bank in Brussels and the Netherlands. It was a product of several mergers, and this has been a huge political issue. This would be in the U.S., it would be like an Enron or something similar. There was lots of funny business going on involving Fortis. All right. The U.S. litigation had gotten dismissed even before Morrison, so he couldn't sue in the U.S. Seeking a hospitable forum that would accommodate both U.S. and European institutional investors, plaintiffs commenced litigation in both Belgium and the Netherlands, with the Demmerer firm serving as an aggregator, and another one being a VEB. VEB is a Dutch word, initials stand for VEB, which is a Dutch shareholder association, playing the primary role in aggregating institutional investors from all across Europe and the United States, also Asia too. 2 stichtings were formed. Stichting Fortis Effect, which was principally composed of Belgium and Dutch shareholders, and Stichting Investor Claims Against Fortis, CCAF, which was principally founded by Grant and Eisenhofer for U.S. and European shareholders and global institutional investors. They each formed their own stichting, so they each would have control rights. Neither one really trusted the other. Okay. Now, 2 well-known American firms, Grant and Eisenhofer and Kessler Topaz, which is a Philadelphia securities litigation firm, coordinated the plaintiff's side of the Wickham action, and they negotiated litigation funding with a third-party funder. And they obtained loser pays insurance with the premiums paid by the third-party funder. And the premiums here were several million dollars, okay? Although they never signed, they did sign up institutional investors to retainers, but the American firms never appeared in court. They saw that the Dutch counsel that they hired was compensated on an hourly basis, so the counsel appearing in court was fully in compliance with the classic fee arrangements of being paid for hours work. And of course the firms loved it because this wasn't contingent to them. They were being paid as they went by the third party funder. Okay, now the Fortis settlement still needs to be approved, but the settlement was over $1.3 billion. And $1.3 billion would be very large in the United States. It was off the charts by orders of magnitude in terms of any settlement that Europe had seen. $1.3 billion in securities litigation. Okay, now the settlement still has not been approved by the Amsterdam Court of Appeals, but no one is challenging it. And I am told they're expecting a decision within a month. I'm told that by Stuart Grant. We'll see if he's right or wrong. Never excessively modest, the American plaintiffs' counsels have proclaimed their victory on their websites as a symbol that they're ready now to lead investors worldwide to other YCAM settlements. If they can first establish some stick-ting-like litigation, then they can generalize it through an opt-out class action, because the YCAM procedure is an opt-out class action, meaning you can cover everyone in the universe so long as you've got one citizen from the Netherlands participating in the case. And actually, in most of these cases, there is a little bit of litigation in the U.S. suing on behalf of the ADRs. ADRs stand for American Depository Receipts, and they're usually 1, 2, 3% of the total shares that are outstanding. So there'll be litigation in the U.S., which is a basis for getting some discovery before you sue in Europe, pursuant to either the stick-ting device for the initial stage or the YCAM settlement for the final stage. Okay, so there are a lot of entrepreneurial attorneys out there from the U.S. now trying to sign up clients for a variety of class actions, a variety of group procedures in Europe. Now, what's the impact of these recent settlements? The $1.337 billion settlement in Fortis is the largest European mass claim settlement. It does not stand alone. There have been settlements in other countries, Vivendi in France, Royal Bank of Scotland in the UK, and the Olympus Corporation in Japan for $92 million, which was again done by these same firms using the device of claims aggregators getting together the plaintiffs. That has produced a seeming opportunity, and there are American firms seeking to sign up clients in the Netherlands. There's even one American firm that's opened a German office. What they are focusing on is, of course, Volkswagen, which is the most obvious and seemingly easiest target out there. But there is no class action procedure in Germany. There is something instead called the CapMug, or capital markets law, which permits consolidation of cases and a bellwether trial. Okay. In the Volkswagen case, American plaintiffs' firms, Grant and Eisenhofer, Kessler Topaz, and Bernstein Litowitz, Labaton Sukero firm, four or five different firms, have all played a role in signing up clients, institutional investors, and seeking to see how they can proceed. The German court has granted a certification that there will be a bellwether trial. So they won the first round, that there will be a bellwether trial. What happens next, I'm going to come to, because there are different ways you can go. But at this moment, the claims aggregators are scouring the world. DRRT, go to their website and see this, and Deminar are looking for more claimants to sign up and get involved in that German CapMug bellwether trial. None of this directly offends the European prohibition against contingent fees, because the lawyers are being paid straight fees by the litigation funder. The American law firm doesn't make any appearance in court, so it's not subject to the jurisdiction of the local courts. It's acting as a kind of investment banker, catalyst, entrepreneur in the backdrop. But again, it's knitting together a coalition of the litigation funder, the insurance company, and the claim aggregators who are bringing in basically large claimants. No one really is going out there looking for the small shareholder. That has not yet developed, and that would be a big further leap. Okay, now here's sort of the big question. why does a defendant enter into a YCAM global class settlement? If you can't be sued, why do you settle? It's usually the litigation that is the gun to your head that causes a settlement. Why settle when there is no threat? Well, the defendant is subject to the threat from the Stichtings. If it was going to settle with a Stichting having 1,000, 2,000 claimants to it, that will attract some publicity. And the corporation probably does fear that the publicity incident to the settlement will draw other plaintiffs with unknown claims out of the woodwork. If someone announces that there's this $300 million settlement with the Stichting, then people who are also investors in that company may say, well, why can't I do that? I'm going to sue in my country and see if I can get a settlement also. And by the way, what the defendant company fears is that everyone will use the settlement with the Stichting as the ground floor from which they want to negotiate a better settlement. That's what you paid them. We're even larger. We want you to pay us more. Okay, so what's the advantage of the Wichting settlement? The advantage is that you can bind all claimants all at once. You can say the same day we are going to settle that Stichting, we're also going to have a White Camp settlement. The Stichting had maybe 1% of our shareholders or less in it, but now we're going to expand that to 99 or 100%, possibly leaving out the U.S. people who are being suing off in an ADR litigation in the United States. Okay, that's the first advantage. You can get everybody all at once. They'll have a right to opt out, but people do not exercise their right to opt out, or certainly the smaller shareholder does not. And here's the second advantage. The claimants the opt-out claimants, that is, the claimants who are brought in to the YCAM settlement, may receive substantially less than the people who are in the Stichting. You had actual clients that you signed up to retainers, you're representing them, and now you're going to get the other 90% of all shareholders. The settlement that you agree to with the corporate defendant may say $10 a share for those in the Stichting, $8 a share for the rest. That's heresy in the United States. You couldn't do that. That kind of discrimination would say you're not providing adequate representation. But that assumes you owe something called a fiduciary duty to all the people in the class. Those are not yet evolved concepts in Europe. And what really attracts the corporate general counsel is, you mean I can settle with the Stichting for X and for X minus a quarter for everyone else? Now that's an attractive way to settle with all these people. They'll have a right to opt out, but they'll not utilize that right, and suddenly I will have this settlement binding everyone in the universe. And under European law, a judgment of the highest court or of a high court in the jurisdiction has to be accepted by every other European court. One of the cute little tricks here is when the court approves the settlement, that's a judgment. The Netherlands treats the approval of the settlement as a judgment which triggers the binding authority of a European judgment before all the European courts. That could be tested. Where that will go, I don't know, but that is the goal that they have. Okay. Now, in this world, it's obvious that class counsel become subject to serious conflicts that make the conflicts in the U.S. minor by comparison. If you can settle the same claims of the same shareholders at different levels, treating the ones that you signed up personally to much more, well, that's going to give some, sooner or later there's going to be some reaction to that. The plaintiff's lawyers I talked to say, well, why shouldn't the active shareholder get more than the passive shareholder? I can respond to that, but their claim is, well, they were active in litigation for years in the Stichting, so they deserve 25% more than the passive shareholders who come in on the last day without even any consent. Whether that argument will stand up, well, so far, all these settlements have been approved, and some of these settlements have had significant differences between what the active and the passive shareholders get. Okay, now let's go talk briefly about Volkswagen again. On March 14th, just about 1 year ago today, plus 2 or 3 days, Grant Eisenhofer and Kessler Topaz caused a suit to be filed in Brunswick, Germany, which is the location of the Volkswagen headquarters, on behalf of 278 institutional investors. These investors came from Europe, the U.S., Canada, Australia, and Asia, using a German law firm they hired, TSAP. The litigation is being provided by an Ireland-based hedge fund called Claims Funding Europe. Now, by the way, the people who provide third-party funding are disproportionately hedge funds, not banks. They like taking this kind of risk. No one has disclosed what the arrangement is. Are they going to get a percentage of the recovery, or are they going to get their amount plus X percent? We don't know what the arrangement is. That's exactly what a court should be focusing on, because the conflicts surrounding litigation finance are equally as great as the conflicts surrounding the attorney putting together this two-tier deal. Okay, now this is not a class action. This is something that's equivalent to an American consolidation of mass torts, and there is a bellwether trial that has been scheduled. Okay, now the strategy. I don't know if this is true, but everyone who is a close student of this process says, well, the strategy is obvious. They're going to try to get the bellwether trial successfully resolved in Germany, which puts a price tag on all of this. The bellwether trial may say the claims of a Volkswagen owner with a 2.0 liter engine are worth X thousand dollars. Okay? Once you have that, then you may take all of this lock, stock, and barrel over to the Netherlands and do a white camp settlement, because then you'd be able to bind everyone else in the universe who isn't already been paid out of the U.S. settlement, so that you can, in effect, generalize the bellwether trial, covering maybe 1 or 2% of the owners, to a universal settlement in the Netherlands. And as that, because of that anticipation, we have several American law firms that are running around the Netherlands setting up shop and signing up clients to institutions to retainer agreements. Well, here it's claimant, but they're institutional drivers of cars. There are various firms that might have 100 or more Volkswagen to sign up for. Okay, so we have lawyers smelling blood and signing up people all across Europe for a possible white camp settlement, although we haven't yet had the bellwether trial. That could be a template that could be used over and over. Some decision by a bellwether trial or a stick-ting suit that gives you a price tag and then a generalization of that in a white camp settlement. Let me go to an evaluation. Obviously, I've been hinting that I see some problems here. Above all, the new European approach is expensive. The third-party funder will want a contract guaranteeing it a substantial percentage, possibly as much as 50% of the recovery. And the court, unless it asks, is not going to know about that. But there is generally no requirement in Europe that the court approve the fee award or the distribution of the recovery between the attorney, between the class members, and the attorneys with whom they have contingent agreements. Okay, that's issue one. None of the requirements of the EC's 2013 recommendation seem to apply. They may be violated, but they don't apply because nothing in this is a class action except for a settlement class action, which already existed since 2005 in the Netherlands and is fairly popular there. Defendants like having the ability to settle and the de facto ability to settle cheap. Okay, American lawyers involved in the process tell me that they have had no difficulty at all in signing up prestigious European law firms to represent them in stick-ting litigation or in Germany. Now, in the U.S., if you tried to sign up a law firm to sue a major bank, they would say never, will be banned forever from the field. But that's not been a problem in Germany in suing Volkswagen, one of the largest, best-known German companies. In fairness, these recent cases, not only the Stichting cases, but the Vivendi, Royal Bank of Scotland, and Olympus in Japan, and now Volkswagen, have all involved large public scandals. Everyone knew about the scandal. Everyone expected some kind of resolution. No one is shocked if the company is finally having to pay the people who've been allegedly injured. Few have sympathy for Volkswagen, even in Germany, where prosecutors are beginning to close in on some Volkswagen officers. That, to me, means it's going to be a big, big step to go from this kind of mega scandal to the standard stock drop case involving a short-term decline in the company's stock price. I don't know if it'll go that way. These cases are being litigated against a largely non-existent legal background. There is no law in any of these countries as to what the damages for securities fraud is. The U.S. has hundreds of decisions on securities fraud, when you get this measure, when you get that measure. But in these cases, the plaintiffs may be able to sue for rescissionary relief. They may be able to sue for the benefit of the bargain. There is just no law dealing with damages and most of the other issues because there's no history of securities litigation. Okay, so entrepreneurial litigation, like it or not, seems to be coming to Europe, but without the class action or the contingent fee. You're getting it, but without the names that you always hated and wouldn't accept. It's coming by the back door. Now, some final thoughts. The rationale for American entrepreneurial litigation is that it's necessary to permit the litigation of negative value claims. We always talk about negative value claims. There are no negative value claims yet being litigated either in the Volkswagen case or in the original Stichting settlements. We have, once you do the universal opt-out settlement under the Whitecamp statute, you will cover the negative value claimants, but there aren't any American-style notice firms, the kind we were just hearing from, setting up offices yet in Europe. There is no way, so far at least, that we're going to find all the social media resources applied to notifying the negative value claimants. I don't think they're going to know about a settlement in Germany or the Netherlands, simply because the court or the European press covers it. So the negative value claimant, which was the rationale for all this, is not clearly benefited by these procedures to this point, which to my mind means there has to be some work done on making this work for everybody. Okay, the plaintiffs, so far in European litigation, are large institutional investors, and they're pretty good representing themselves, and they're the people that the DRRTs and the Demonors reach. I could imagine, with a little judicial pressure, that they could use social media to reach the negative claimants as well. Okay, the Whitecamp settlement is also very vulnerable to an American problem called the reverse auction. Let's suppose that you have that bellwether trial and there's a recovery and now Volkswagen would like to settle because they don't want more of this litigation brought by many more and more holders and they want to do a Whitecamp settlement. Who do they want to do it with? They want to do it with the cheapest bidder they can find on the plaintiff's side. So there are lots of plaintiff's firms out there willing to do a Whitecamp settlement, and you can ask, what would they settle for? And if you play one against the other, you can get someone to be the bottom bidder. In the U.S., we call that the reverse auction. It can be largely stopped in the U.S. because if there's a multi-district litigation, there's a transferee judge who can supervise this, and he'll have all the parties before him. There won't be an in-run easily done around him. There's nothing like that in Europe, and I suspect we're going to see some efforts in some case fairly soon to try to run a reverse auction and get a universal Whitecamp settlement from the lowest bidder. Because after all, it takes two to settle, and defendants can choose who they want to settle with. Okay, the role of the American plaintiff's firm may be transitional. It may be that others can learn to do this. But right now, they are taking some risk. They are dealing with the third-party funder. I don't know what the relationships are, but they may give guarantees to the third-party funder. They are making upfront payments to the liability insurer. Okay, maybe others will replace them. There's also one possible synergy here. To the extent that there is litigation in the United States under ADRs, you can get discovery in the United States before there's any suit brought in Germany. Yes, you're only representing a small number of shareholders in the ADR litigation, but U.S. discovery is very broad, and you can get the information you want, and then you can package it off to Europe to frame your original complaint either in a Stichting suit or a German cap mug litigation, and eventually use it as a basis for negotiating the Whitecamp settlement. So there may be some utility in having an American presence here. If the U.S. experience with class actions is any lesson, it's that we need a court that supervises the plaintiff's attorney and the competition among plaintiff's attorneys. Problems do develop. That doesn't yet seem to be something that's within the capability of any of these European courts that are supervising this. Okay, the 2013 recommendations that I talked about earlier, which were very critical and suspicious of U.S. litigation coming to Europe, were going to be renewed in 4 years. Well, 2013 plus 4 years is 2017. The EU is supposed to go back and look at what they said in those recommendations. They're beginning to look a little bit dated in light of settlements that are coming down, such as the Fortis settlement. Again, we haven't had a decision from the Amsterdam Court of Appeals, but once that decision is in, I think Europe may want to be looking at this again. I don't know what the reaction will be. The Dutch defense bar loves the Whitecamp settlements being very useful for them. Okay, so entrepreneurial litigation seems to be coming from the U.S. to Europe, but with one big difference. As I said at the outset, entrepreneurial litigation developed easily in the United States because we had a pre-existing culture. We had the culture there of contingent fee lawyers doing personal injury work from the 19th century on. For 100 years, you sued the train company, the railroad company, any other manufacturer on a contingent fee basis. The plaintiff's bar was very familiar with all this. The culture preexisted the class action. The class action fit in easily with the culture. We don't have that culture in Europe. We may get a de facto substitute through the White Cam statute for the class action, but how that will fit with a culture that doesn't support it and may be offended by it, that's going to be a very interesting question. Can you transport legal rules to different legal cultures? Everything we know suggests difficulty with something like that, but we are seeing this come through the mechanism of American entrepreneurs rather quickly. We'll see what happens. I don't predict what the outcome will be. I predict, though, that we're going to have, both in Volkswagen and the final approval of Fortis, some moments where there'll be a lot of reflection in Europe. Okay, so my final statement to you, I use this for American audiences only, but on this note, I think there should be some questions, there should be some inflection, and the rest of the panel now has a target to focus on. Gentlemen, the floor is yours. Thank you very much.
So, Dr. Flavian is next.
I will have to start with an apology because I'm going to touch a bit also on the Dutch system. I think it reflects the future of global litigation. But don't worry, you will not hear the same thing twice. I cannot be as magnificent as Professor Coffey presented it. I will start with an exercise, okay? It will actually reflect what we are trying to do in this conference. I would like to refer you, please look at what you're wearing. Look at what you've eaten this morning, the car you're driving, how you flew to this conference, or perhaps at what you have recently ordered online. In almost all these cases, the manufacturers are from different jurisdictions. The world has become a tiny place in terms of global trade. As things stand nowadays, if such manufacturers are acting unlawfully, they will not be sued in many countries and will not be fully accountable for their unlawful profits. It is a common interest, regardless of each one's jurisdiction, to protect global trade. We would like to have legal tools in order to act against any wrongdoer, and we would like that any illegal activity would not be profitable for the wrongdoer. For example, look at the chart which is now being presented. If an international food provider who acts unlawfully and therefore will gain unlawful profits in addition to its legal activity, you can see that in the left column. However, such an international provider will be sued only in few jurisdictions, probably and mainly in the US, and therefore this provider retains unlawful profits gained in other countries, as presented in the second column. If this is the case, the effect of deterrence will not be optimal because the unlawful behavior of this trader was still profitable. Optimal deterrence is reached only where the illicit profits are totally removed, as you can see in the third column. As I told you, as things stand nowadays, there is no one legal procedure to cater for misconduct of transnational trade. In fact, according to a survey conducted by Deborah Hensler in 2011, there were at that time at least 21 countries that have adopted some type of different class actions, some of the class actions that we know here from Israel and other have adopted some other form of consolidated group proceedings in addition or instead of class actions. Since that time, England, Belgium, and even France made some changes to the system, and the European Union, as you heard, gave its guidelines in this area, which are, to my mind, very modest and disappointing. The procedures vary from one country to another. Some adopted the opt-in machinery rather than the opt-out system that we are used to see in Israel and the US. Some models have wider scope, which enables the introduction of class action in many areas of law, like the US or Sweden, and some limit the potential class representatives to listed organizations only, like France and I think Italy, whilst others allow private actors to play the key role in the enforcement procedure like Israel and the US. Diana yesterday talked about the Danish model, and in this unique model, they allow the public regulator, the consumer ombudsman, to bring opt-out class actions, whereas private parties can bring only opt-in class actions. In many European countries, contingency fees are not permitted. Each of these differences influences dramatically the use of collective procedure. To some extent, I think that the European got something wrong. Many European countries, as well as the European Parliament, have fears from the opt-out model. However, the opt-out mechanism on its own, without contingency fees, does not produce many class actions and should not be blamed for creating a flood of actions. This conclusion is based on a study of the Portuguese model, which allows opt-out class actions without contingency fees. The UK approach, which limits class action to specific sectors, I think is not needed. Look at the Swedish jurisdiction, which allows collective redress in almost any civil matter, yet it does not bring with it many class action. I think that the European approach, negative approach towards contingency fees is also unnecessary, as this gap is anyhow filled, as you heard before, by private funders who support collective redress actions in Europe in return of contingency fees of about 30%. I think that consumer redress is a common problem everywhere. If in this regard the Israeli jurisdiction shows that once you establish a class action legislation, most action would be consumer related. In fact, in Israel, about 78% of the actions are consumer related. 15% are relating to the food industry, for example, claims about the size of food packets, food labelings, wrong ingredients. About 13% of the actions are brought in the area of telecommunication and internet. 10% of the actions are against banks, and about 9% of the actions are against insurance companies. Looking at the Spanish jurisdiction, for example, the examination of the 49 actions mentioned in the European evaluation study from 2010 reveals that 28 of the collective actions in Spain concern the collapse of Spanish chain of language school and therefore are not typical, but the remaining 21 actions were bought in consumer-related areas, very similar to the Israeli market: banks, gas, telecom, food, pharmaceuticals. So we can draw the conclusion that these markets are more susceptible to class action. Therefore, if we are looking at the global procedure, this area requires intervention. Sometimes cases are very similar from one jurisdiction to the other. You may look at specific cases, for example, the Israeli famous case which concerned milk contamination. It was found in that the largest milk producer in Israel, Tnuva, had mixed fees for the negotiation of the Dutch settlement. The Chief Justice, our Chief Justice, former Justice, asked what the outcome for the class members. So the outcome of the class members In the US case was about $82 million, equal I think almost to the fees that was paid to the lawyers. And in the Europe the outcome was about $350 million. The Amsterdam court opened its doors even wider later in the Vedior and Converium cases, deciding that even if the group of injured class members includes only few Dutch persons, it has still jurisdiction to deal with the proposed settlement. However, and as you heard before, although the judge mechanism is an excellent vehicle to reach an opt-out settlement for non-US claimant, the drawback is that there is no way to compel a plaintiff to enter into an agreement under the Dutch system. It is strictly a voluntary procedure. However, and as you heard before, the recent Fortis case proved that the US law firm learned how to bend the rules. Again, Grinton Eisofer and Topaz Kelsler, they brought two actions, one in the Utrecht court in Netherlands and the other one in Belgium. The separate action forced the defendants to agree to consolidation of the case later on as part of the Dutch settlement. This action led in 2016 to a $1.3 billion global settlement to resolve all shareholders' fraud claims stemming from the Fortis disaster's 2007 acquisition. It is therefore presumed that in the Volkswagen case, the US law firm filed an action in Germany on behalf of some of Volkswagen investors in relation to the emission scandal in order to force Volkswagen to settle the case later in the court of Amsterdam. Two last comments. 2 days ago, we celebrated Rabeea's new book. In this book, he claims that there is a right for self-representation, but in the end, he reaches the conclusion that it is an empty right because you must go to court with a lawyer. It's a complex work and you need a professional. This is very connected to our conference because consumers have many rights, but they remain empty because nobody will take a negative expected value claim to court without this instrument of class action. And to sum it all in few words, we share common needs, especially now the trade become borderless. I think that in essence, consumer redress is common to all of us, wherever we come from and whatever language we are speaking. We, as lawyers, should try to keep things simple and unified as much as possible. Thank you very much.
David.
So Professor Davis said I was going to be brief, so I have to stick to that. We need to catch up a little bit, so I'm happy to oblige with that. Hope I accomplish it. Just two quick observations for me being here today and at this conference. I went to law school, graduated law school many years ago, and I don't think I ever could have imagined sharing a panel with Professor Coffey and sharing a podium with Professor Miller. Read their books, read their articles, listened to their tapes, and here I am today taking part with them, and it's very gratifying and it's quite an honor. Second observation is after 5 years of practicing as a lawyer, as a class action lawyer, and then I spent the last 25 years almost as a class action settlement administrator, I don't think I ever imagined being at a class action conference in Israel. And it's really gratifying to be here in a country that I love so much. And it's just something that I'm very proud of to be part of. I'm not sure I'm the right person to be talking about the future of class actions. I'm not a practicing lawyer anymore. I'm not much of an academician, if any, at all. Everybody on this panel has a couple of initials in front of their name. I don't. The only thing I have in front of my name are the things my wife calls me, which I won't discuss right now. And But I do have the perspective of being an administrator, working side by side on these cases and seeing what's going on from an administration perspective. So I can speak to that. And I have some thoughts on what might be coming into the future from that perspective alone. But before I do that, as there are several preeminent plaintiff's lawyers in this room, I just wanted to reinforce one of the messages we've heard from Professor Miller both last evening and a few minutes ago this morning. And that is, there have been numerous attempts in the United States to constrain class actions, whether it be by statute, and a couple of examples were the Private Securities Litigation Reform Act, which I lived through in 1995, and the Class Action Reform Act most recently, or by Supreme Court decisions. And each time, the plaintiff's bar has been creative and industrious in finding new approaches within the law to bring new cases. So from my perspective, I expect that this will continue no matter the changes to come. And even with the difficult law that's now in front of the House, I do have great confidence in that bar. And it goes without saying, I have to say this sitting here, standing here today, that my partners and I have been quite honored to have worked with all these firms that are here today. So from my perspective as a settlement administrator, clearly the future of global class actions will include the use of new techniques and new technology to improve notice and claims administration. But given the time constraints, I'm not going to go into all the minutia, plus we heard a lot about that from the previous panel this morning. But I do want to point out, and it was an area that was covered earlier, but I think it needs to be reinforced, which is I do expect tremendous change in the way payments are made to class members. Just consider your own daily lives and how easily it is to use online tools to move your money, make payments, or even purchase things online. And now there are now tools like, we heard about PayPal and even Venmo, which my kids love, that make it so easy to pay or be paid. So for those of us, as an example, in the U.S. who love our Starbucks coffee, I know we're all missing it. Aroma's pretty good, by the way, for those of you who don't like coffee. You can now order and pay for your coffee with an app. So perhaps this is a fantasy, but could you imagine a day, and maybe it's coming, where the use of an app could actually happen in the realm of class action settlements and administration? I know it sounds crazy, but I do remember 10 to 15 years ago, we never could have imagined that email would be a prime mechanism for direct mail noticing. And yet here we are today, and many of the cases that we administer, the use of email, putting aside some of the new techniques, but that's now the most preferred method of direct mail notification to class members. I did want to raise or leave with you with two examples of, maybe it's a trend, maybe it's not, that I've dealt with recently that are developing, I think, into global possibilities. The first involved the liquidation of the Yukos oil company in Russia. Without getting all the details of what happened with Yukos, and it's an incredibly complex situation, including politically, several years ago a board was appointed in London to liquidate the company and distribute the company's assets to shareholders around the world. The board came to me to help them develop and assist with the distribution. I just assumed, okay, great, we'll send out checks. No, they didn't want to just do it that simply. What they wanted was that the case be handled just like a class action, with all of the bells and whistles of a class action, meaning they wanted to send out notice, set up a website, set up an international call center, process claims, a deadline, and so on. The reason they wanted to do this was that in case someone complained about the process, they could defend it by saying, what do you mean? This is exactly what is done in the United States and the way a securities class action is handled. And that's a tried and true decades-old process. So that, I thought, was a very interesting example of using the American system in a non-judicial context. And then most recently, we were contacted by another non-US company that I cannot disclose that has a similar issue and wants to develop a compensation program. Although they are not in a court of law anywhere in their home country, this company wants a program to be modeled exactly like a US class action, again, with all of its bells and whistles, a notice process, claims processing, a very strict claims deadline. So as we heard earlier from Professor Coffey, it is quite ironic that while we are seeing attempts to limit or cripple class actions in the US, non-US companies are actually looking at the class action model for guidance, even in the administration context. While these are only two examples, and maybe or maybe it does not make a trend, I do see this as a potential change in the landscape as we look into the future. Thank you for your time and for participating in this incredible conference. Let's do it again here in Israel soon.
Professor Voet. Intensity is this one. I think it's this one. Yes. Now, how do I open this? Like this?
Let's try.
It's this one. Yeah.
This one here?
Yeah, maybe there. No, here. No, I think it's here, yeah. You see?
Very good.
Okay. I feel a little bit like one of these lawyers before Judge Breyer, and I have to make my argument in 2 minutes. I have the impression there's a virtual stopwatch here, and that will start sounding after 2 minutes. I want to make 5 points. The first point is, what are we talking about in Europe? This, ladies and gentlemen, has costed me a lot of time and effort. It's a little bit the first time that I showed this, so I'm quite proud of this. It's the number of class actions that are being brought in Europe. And I'm going to leave the numbers there as they are. I'm not going to comment on them. The general observation is that there are not many cases, with the exception of Poland and Portugal, but Poland is something special. And you can do two things with that. Proponents of class actions will say, you see, we need more and better class action regulations. Opponents will say, you see, they don't work. There are no cases, so we need something else.
We need American lawyers.
Me? Second point, you can address this issue from a procedural point of view. I am a proceduralist, and proceduralists love to take their binoculars or their magnifying glasses and look into all those little technical rules and comment on them. I have done so in quite a lot of articles, and in general, there are some procedural issues with these European class actions. We've heard about them. There's lack of appropriate funding and financing rules. There's problems with scope. There's problems with standing. There are a bunch of procedural design flaws, which leads to ineffectiveness and which leads to a lack of enforcement. To be honest, ladies and gentlemen, most of these European class actions are the result of a political compromise, trying to reconcile the diverging interests of opponents and proponents. The goal is not to create an effective and efficient mechanism. No, the goal of a lot of countries where you see these debates is just to have a sort of compromise. Whether the thing works or not is irrelevant. For example, that was the case in Belgium, was also, for example, the case in other countries. See the numbers that I've shown you. Third point, you should all buy this book. This book actually takes a step back and approaches the issues from a more contextual context. In French, they say reculer pour mieux sauter. And in that book, we have, together with a fantastic group of scholars, I was one of them, fantastic people, great friends, and we have made a bunch of case studies. And all of these case studies actually want to show that you have to look at the broader context. And one of the main conclusions of the book is that that discussion between public and private enforcement is completely outdated. One of the greatest legal minds in Belgium was Professor Walter van Gerven, who was an advocate general also at the European Court of Human Rights. And already in the 70s, he said that traditional private law has become public private law, and public law has been privatized. And I think he was absolutely right. So looking at public-private law, public versus private enforcement dogma, and trying to resolve the problem of class actions is, I think, completely wrong. Read the book. Second point, and I refer to what Professor Micklet said yesterday, we have to look at the transnational global context. As Diana said, it's a mess regarding the Volkswagen case in Europe. What we need, what we actually need, is a sort of European MDL procedure. Whether that will work or not is the question, but we need a coordinating tool to get all these procedures together. And finally, and to my surprise, it has not been mentioned a lot. I've been to a lot of class action conferences where there was a focus on this, is the cultural context. I think in Europe it will be extremely difficult to create a sort of European class action model. I think one of the European commissioners I once spoke to said that nationalism is a sticky thing, also when you want to create legislation. The Dutch system will always prioritize out of court and consensual model. Any German model will maximize party autonomy. The Belgian and French models will adhere to organizational plaintiffs. And the Scandinavian models will always use public models. So creating principles that transcend the national context will be extremely difficult. Fourth point, there is this new world. I recently called them new technologies. I will not go into details. They were discussed previously in other panels. There is consumer dispute resolution, and there is regulatory redress. I am not saying, ladies and gentlemen, that this is the holy grail. What I just want to mention is that these techniques work in specific contexts, and they work in specific countries. And a lot of these techniques were actually market-driven. In a lot of European countries, the judicial system is dysfunctional, and the market has tried to create alternatives, other techniques to deal with these scattered damages. And you can find some of the examples on the slide. And you can criticize them. You can have, I mean, you can say, I don't like them, but I'm very sorry, but these mechanisms and these alternatives are here to stay. They will not go away, because the market itself has created them, and in some contexts, they bloody hell work. Look at, for example, in Denmark. Look at, for example, in the UK, where you have the Regulatory Enforcement and Sanctions Act. If you look at the numbers, it sometimes works. Sometimes, if it's well designed, and it does not work in all contexts. See my remark regarding the national contexts or legal culture. My final point is, how should one deal with these two different worlds? And I think this refers to the so-called paradigm problem. There's an old conflict between a vision in which courts are the central authoritative form of dispute resolution, or whether less formal methods can or should be adopted. And in essence, this is a debate a clash between the principles of legality versus self-determination. Does the state have a monopoly in deciding individual legal rights as defined by the state, or may they do so themselves without authoritarian interference? And for example, an illustration of that is the debate between or regarding mediation, that mediation undermines the application of law. Dame Hazel again once argued that the outcome of mediation is not about just settlement, it's just about settlement. However, I do think that there is a paradigm shift, a new paradigm is emerging, and this is not the egg of Columbus. This new paradigm implies a different relationship between courts and certain trusted, and I underline trusted, forms of ADR and regulatory bodies. And this is not a discussion about which model, which system is superior. It's about the existence of a number of optional pathways versus the quality of each pathway. And in my very humble opinion, I think this paradigm, this new paradigm, should be applied in the European collective redress orbit. What is needed to tackle the problem of mass cases is, and again I quote Professor van Gerven, a multi-layered framework of regulation, lawmaking, and law application. It's not about white bread versus brown bread, it's about how the bread is being baked. It's connecting all these different dots and creating a sort of integrated, holistic framework, what was once called in a European study, and I think Evelyn was involved in that, a dispute resolution continuum. And as was mentioned before, in some cases ADR and regulatory redress will work, but in other cases you need private enforcement, you need class actions. We will see, ladies and gentlemen, what the future in Europe will bring. I think that European class actions are like a box of chocolates. And to quote Forrest Gump, you will never know what you're going to get. Thank you.
Despite that final note of uncertainty, I actually do think I heard a prediction in there somewhere, which is that American lawyers are going to move with Israeli judges to the Netherlands and use Dutch jurisdiction to solve the world's problems. I think that's where we landed, which I didn't expect there would be consensus. We're probably out of time, given time constraints, so if we could thank our panelists and move to the summary. Good.